Welcome to my series of overhauling clock movements. This particular one will be for a Jauch 77 grandfather movement with Westminster chime and moon dial. And so if you have one of these type of clocks sitting around the house and it's not doing much of anything, why not repair it and do a proper overhaul to it and get it running for another 10 or 20 years? The Jauch movements are no longer purchasable, so it's up to you to make this clock sing again. This is the chime release star lever, or gear, or whatever you want to call it. As it turns around, I installed this lever again so you could see what it does. That's for the quarter hours, and the hour I painted with a little bit of blue ink. So the quarter hour, three quarter hours only lifted a certain amount, and the full hour lifts it up high enough where this lever causes the strike to go into warning. Right there. The other ones do not allow it to go. Slide out this assembly. Not only will you have this lever with the screw on it, but the other one is just free on the inside. That will come out, and sometimes they hide a little washer in between the assemblies. I'm not sure if that's for Hermley or Jauch, but be very careful. And sometimes those washers are held in by previous oil that only after you release it and put it on the workbench will that little washer slide off, and then you're going to lose it.
Taking up the gathering pallet now, and I'll be using a gear puller made specifically and sold by clock suppliers. I kind of like this one. It handles most of it. It's good and heavy duty, so you're not going to break it. I'm about to split the plates now. Front side is down. I have it sitting on my standoffs. This way it clears the minute arbor so it doesn't hit the table. And
I'm ready.
Here's the inside of the plate, and you can see that little spring right here that goes through the front plate and holds the flirt, the strike warning flirt. It holds it downwards. Has an interesting shape to it, probably to clear a wheel or an arbor on the inside.
I guess you can see the ultrasonic does quite a good job when you know how to control it. I added a little bit of heat this time, and the ammonia really shines up the brass nice. Here are some of the other components. I decided to throw in the chime hammers there. It still has to be taken apart, but boy, did it eliminate a lot of hand polishing. I just gotta clean up the inside and be done.
Here's the chime assembly all put back together, and I just wanted to cover lubrication. You can put some heavy mainspring oil, either the light or the medium mainspring oil, on this area right here, as well as the other area for the chime barrel. And I would use some synthetic grease on this face of the teeth. And what you can do is just put it on one tooth on each one of the discs, and as it rotates, it'll spread the grease to the appropriate area.
The idle wheel reinstalled so it can transmit the power to the rest of the chain. I've got the minute arbor lubricated and reassembled. Now I'm going to start putting the rest of the wheels. I have everything ready for polishing right now. Have all my wheels. I took the two fly governors. The strike is on the right side and the chime is on the left side. I've already taken the arbor out of the left side, mounted it inside the lathe there, and I'll be turning on the lathe and polishing up that particular pivot.
Here we are back at the lathe doing some polishing. The pivots so far have been looking good. I did about four wheels so far, both sides of course.
I'm about to install all the wheels between the plates to find out which pivots and which pivot holes need to be addressed. I just put the chime sight in. Don't pay attention to the minute arbor. Here's the chime. This is the front plate here. And just from an observation standpoint, here's one that's probably tight enough. It doesn't have much tilt to it. The winding arbors generally have
a tiny, tiny bit of play in them. American movements have a lot more than
that. There's the time when you're probably going to say to yourself, oh my God, how do I get all these pivots in there? They're all leaning and laying all over the place. Try to put the bottom plate where the winding arbors are in first, and then put little the little nuts on them just very loosely, and then work your way upwards into the smaller pivots.
It took about 5 minutes, and I was able to get all of the pivots in where they live. I'm going to move the time side now. There seems to be quite a bit of resistance in its moving, so I know that the train, we know the pivots are nicely polished, but now we're looking at the holes themselves and feeling how much resistance there is. Since I was talking about the verge, I went ahead and installed the pendulum post with the escape wheel, the verge and the crutch, and the rear pivot has a lot of play in it. Since I'm about to do 14 bushings on this particular movement, the chances of error are multiplied, so I wanted to give myself the best chance possible not to have any errors whatsoever. And to do that, I use a preacher. This was invented by one of the masters, whether it be Huckabee or Perkins or... I'm not quite sure who did it, but it's a marvelous little thing. You just take a little piece of mild steel and put in three screws into it, held accurately to a certain depth, and each screw was put in a lathe, and so you have a sharp center, exactly on center. And what you do is before you do a bushing, you simply line up. I painted one side red there. That's the part that goes inside the pivot hole. And you simply put it in there, and you find a place where the other two screws are hitting brass and not going into another hole. You hold it with your right or left hand, and then you tap on these two screws, and it puts two little divots in the brass. So just in case you drill this hole off-center and put in a bushing off-center, you can put in a blank bushing, reline up these two screws with their little divots, and then tap the third one, and that'll give you the exact center. I got the strike side back in right now, and we're going to test out everything, all the bushings that I put in. First thing we're going to do is to check out the shake. This one's got good shake. That's the fly governor. The next wheel. Next wheel looks good.
By the way, the way I moved those bushings slightly outwards was with a staking set. This happens to be a watchmaker staking set, and I almost never need the anvil. That's more of a watchmaker's type of a tool. I just use the punches, and I select the punch that's a little bit smaller than a bushing, and move the bushing exactly where I want to move it. It's a great little set to have. You can get them on eBay, probably a lot cheaper than the tiny little sets you get for clockmaking. I got a Jacob's chuck that fits into my electric screwdriver. You can pick that up at Sears. And a little bit, it's got a round shank on it, so I simply grab it with the Jacob's chuck. And this way I can drill it without having to go crazy, as long as I don't stab myself when that thing comes through. I'm going to be supporting this because it's probably going to grab as it goes through, and then I'll be in trouble. So you want to make it always safe for yourself. I'm about to punch the bushing in. Get it in a little bit first. It'd be better if I used the punch so I could actually see the bushing going in.
Punched in all the way now, nice and flush, and we're about to open up the hole that got closed slightly by punching it through.
Now I'm about to put the plates together for the final time. Put all the wheels in, and those timing marks that we talked about earlier on the chime side as well as the strike side. Make sure everything is lined up, and then pop it all together. Most of the alignments can be done outside the plates, but the two on the chime side are critical. And the one that's on the strike side, you can be pretty creative with that one. But try to get it the way we had talked about earlier.
About to put the plates together, and I just wanted to show you. Got the movement all together now. Took about 5 minutes. I didn't used to be that fast. But I've taught my fingers how to think for themselves, and the movement just kind of pops together. Kind of automatic now.
Well, I got the movement together, and I put a couple of levers in. They're not held in by the J-clips yet, but that's not real important. What I wanted to do is to show you, I also put the chime cam on there to see how she works. So I'll come right back to you and show you how this mechanism is supposed to work. You see that innocent looking slot right here? Well, besides allowing you to see in there to see the star wheel for the strike side, the other thing to notice is the slot is not cut to the diameter, or I should say the center of rotation of the striking arbor. What this slot does, it allows this pin to be free here, and then this pin, that little bend right here, comes down and it jams up against the plate right here. So the maximum travel of the hammers is, as far as it coming in and touching the chiming rods, is determined by this, the forming of this little wire right here. Make sure you grease it right here. It needs it. Next thing on the big band list is we'll be installing the drive gear and the chime assembly onto the back of the movement. The lubrication for the chime assembly is pretty simple. You just put a little dab of grease on four of the activator teeth on the chime barrel.
Here I got the movement set up on the test stand. This little test stand I made of some extra scrap wood that I had from doing all of these little kitchen cabinets in my shop. And this particular wood, just, you know, it's press board, melamine, I guess they call it. And I put tracks, I put a big piece here with tracks on it so I can adjust the movement up and down. But I have found that the tracks were not necessary. You just want to have that sucker up at the highest that you can work at it, depending on what you like to work from, whether it's standing or whether you're sitting or whatever. Just make it at a comfortable height. You don't need to make it adjustable. Now, if you listen to the beat, it will give you a proper 50% duty cycle, where the space between the tick and the tock and the tock and the tick are going to be equal. Listen. If it was unequal, it will, I'm going to throw it out of beat right now. Right now it's out of beat.
Here we have a finished Jauch, fully overhauled and working perfectly. We have a good swing on the pendulum. Let me advance the hands to the three-quarter mark. There goes warning. Here comes the hour mark. Strike goes into warning. Chime completes and activates the strike. And it should be 1 o'clock right now. And it is. Looks like she's working good. Another little hint to check out the moon dial operation. I put the moon in the center, and you can see it's a little bit off center. It's been running for, just one day really, and the moon is slightly off center, so it looks like the moon dial's working. You can see we have a nice bit of overswing, and it's keeping good time. And it's back to the customer she goes.